Next, we have a very special guest for you. Greg Sucker is probably the most famous Forex trader in the world today. His organization owns trading floors in London, Sydney, South Africa, and the US. He has taught literally thousands of people around the world how to become permanently financially independent. He has taken the most powerful trading strategies from the world of professional trading and simplified them so anyone can use them. To give you a flavor of what you are in for, please watch the video screen.
Get ready, because what you are about to learn may just change your life. Over 100,000 people from over 80 countries have learned from this man how to change their lives forever. He's the founder of the multi-award-winning Knowledge to Action Group, which owns trading floors and trading centers across the globe. Greg is an internationally acclaimed wealth creation expert who has spoken at some of the most exclusive venues in the world, sharing the stage with such gurus as Tony Robbins, Sir Richard Branson, Robert Kiyosaki, T. Harv Eker, and the famous Wolf of Wall Street, Jordan Belfort.
I've traveled the world and I've scoured the earth, and Greg truly is a world-class trader.
Author of numerous books on trading, including the highly successful Financial Freedom Through Forex, Greg is a master of the art of trading, but more importantly, he knows how to coach people to succeed. He's taught people all over the world how they can use the same powerful trading strategies that his full-time professional traders use to great success.
I got about 90 pips out of one currency within about a week of actually doing the course.
After a few coaching sessions, I'm already placing trades.
It is easy to do, and when I say that most sincerely.
My ultimate goal is to have financial freedom.
I am fed up of working in the office.
I actually quit my job in July and took this on full time.
It's not as complicated as it looks.
People always ask me, can I do this? And the answer is, yes, you can. Anybody can do this. It's easy. Most importantly, it works. If you know two things, what to do and when to do it.
Greg is also the driving force behind the Knowledge to Action Foundation, which supports children's charities such as Barnardo's and South Africa's Ubuntu Education Fund. The foundation runs exciting fundraising projects such as the Flying Trader, which allows traders new and experienced to follow Greg's expert trading from a helicopter high over London. There is no one better equipped to show you how to create wealth and financial freedom. Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome Mr. Greg Sucker.
How's everybody doing? Are you good? Are we here to learn how to make some money, yes or no? Okay, good. Well, let me tell you a little bit about what I do. I'm regarded as one of the top Forex traders in the world now. I run trading floors pretty much all over the world, from Sydney, Australia, here to London, to Johannesburg in South Africa, and also over in the US. What I do is I teach people, pretty much like yourselves, how to make an immediate income trading the currency markets. And the way I do that, pretty much, is I have you sit with me or one of my team, and we trade live with you. And in doing that, we find it easy to show people just like yourselves how to take some simple stuff from some of the most successful trading floors around the world, implement it, and get some great results from it. Now, before I get going with how to do all of that, by the way, does everybody here have notes and a pen and a pad and are ready to take some notes on how down to do this? Yes or no? Great. Okay, well, I might, if I can, I'll just indulge me. I'll tell you how I got started in all this, because it's kind of an interesting story. I wasn't a trader when I set out. I started as an IT guy on the trading floor. It was my first job straight out of university, and I sat on a trading floor. I was the guy that when any trading station blew up or went down, I was the one that had something thrown at them, and I had to go fix it. Living in that environment was pretty hectic. There was 42 traders on the floor. They were average age of about 26 years old. They were earning huge money. I was earning about £15,000 a year, which I thought was good at the time. They were earning £15,000 probably every 3 or 4 days. And of course, if their computer blew up while they were in a big trade, obviously I was the one who got it in the neck. So quickly I learned how to support those guys and I got friendly with them. Well, fast forward a few weeks later, I got very friendly with the head trader on the floor and I just wanted to know how the hell they were doing what they were doing to make the money they were making. And they were making a lot of money. I knew nothing about foreign exchange trading before, so it's completely brand new to me. Now, I mucked around a bit. I got friendly with one of the traders. Well, before too long, I left the IT world, realized that wasn't for me, got into trading, had this whirlwind career of trading across 7 trading floors around the world, made currency my master, did it pretty much every waking hour, made a lot of money doing it. And at 27 years old, I decided that I didn't really need to work for an institution anymore. I could go home and I could trade from home. So I set up a trading center or a trading system, if you like, in my lounge, in my front room. And I pretty much traded the European session from about 5:45 in the morning London time to about 11:30. And I made all my money doing just that. And 2 interesting things happened to me at the time. The first thing was I made a lot of money. And the second thing is I got pretty fat. And when I say pretty fat, I was referred to by my friends at the time as the trading bullfrog. I literally was the fattest lad you've ever seen behind a bunch of computer screens trading the currency markets, and that was me. And it's funny, every time I hear myself say that, I feel myself suck my stomach in at the same time. and that's just how it was. And it's a lonely existence, and then the thing you used to do in those days was, as soon as you finished trading, get towards lunchtime, you'd go down to the pub, start drinking a couple of beers and just hang out with whoever was down there. And what would happen is I'd meet people and they'd say, what have you been doing for the day? And I said, well, I've been trading the currency markets, making money. I said, what have you been doing? I see a guy stand there covered in paint. He said, well, I've been painting your neighbor's kitchen. You know, and he'd say, how much money did you make today? And I said, I don't know, £35,000. And he'd sit there and go, fuck off. I'd be like, no, really? Oh, let me just say, if I use the odd blue word, is that okay with yes or no? I'm in Australia, right? You guys are more easygoing. Gee, I've got to tell you, one of the first times I spoke in a big audience like this, it was with Tony Robbins in Singapore, right? Anybody here seen Tony Robbins? Okay, so with Tony Robbins, anyone here been to Singapore? Quick show of hands on Singapore. You know what Singapore's like? It's clean. Singapore is like Legoland. Isn't Singapore like Legoland? Like, it's very clean. You're not allowed to drop chewing gum. Otherwise, they cut your weenie off. I mean, that's a pretty hectic place. I'm going on stage. Tony Robbins is walking off stage, just like this back here. This big old Tony lumbering off the stage, go for it, man. And there's this lady standing there with a clipboard. And she says to me, listen, you're talking for 90 minutes. She went, no swear words, no profanity. Don't say anything out of the ordinary. I was like, I come from a trading floor environment. I'm like, there's going to be a few shits and fucks flying out of me. I'm like, are you sure? She goes, absolutely nowhere. It's completely anti-Singaporean culture. I'm like, okay, fine. So I get on stage and I find myself in this box because I just can't say what I want to say. So I just say to the audience, I said, listen, I just got to be me here and I want to be unleashed and I want to give you 100%, just like I do want to today. But I said, sometimes that comes with the odd profanity and I don't mean it to upset anyone or to be offensive or abusive. It's just who I am. So with permission, can I just be who I am? And of course, this whole Singapore audience and Tony Robbins goes, yay! And I go, thank fuck for that. And of course, the whole audience laughs at him. So I'm in the right place here today. Huh, folks? Yes or no? So anyway, so quickly fast forward. So there I am, trading away. And I noticed that I'd bring people back to my house. I'd sit there in front of the trading screen and they'd watch me trading live. And literally people used to have this experience where they'd just look at the screen and they would just go, fuck. Like, because they'd watch me make £2,000 or £3,000, maybe in 10 or 20 minutes, and they'd never seen that happen before. And of course, what would happen immediately after that is they'd scuttle off down to PC World in London, they'd buy a laptop, and within a few hours, they'd be sat next to me installing trading software. You know, I'm talking about a guy in overalls with a t-shirt on with paint on. He'd just been, you know, decorating. He's there installing software and learning, sitting there learning what I'm doing because he's got inspired by it. Well, I found out a few short years later after I then set up. Fast forward 6 weeks later, I've got 19 people camped out on my lounge room floor, trading the market, smoking cigarettes, drinking coffee, banging away on laptops. I thought it was brilliant. My girlfriend thought it was freaking horrific. The house smelt like a boy's dormitory. I mean, it was just disgusting. One day we came back from a nightclub at 4:30 in the morning, and there's two guys standing at my front door going, "Are you ready to get started?" My girlfriend goes, "That's it." And so, of course, we moved the trading floor out of the house, and we set up the first real trading floor, and it started like that. Unbeknownst to me, I kind of enjoyed the process, not just of carrying on the trading, but teaching people how to do it. I quite enjoyed the kind of camaraderie that created. And before long, we had a trading floor with 18 traders on it, and you know, the kind of world's history after that. But one of the things I noticed is that I was invited to go and speak to a bunch of people who were learning to trade and been to a trading seminar. Anybody here been to maybe a seminar kind of like that before? Quick show of hands on that. That's pretty much the whole room. Well, I did, and I noticed those guys weren't making, you know, they hadn't been trading very much. I met a group of 38 people that used to meet up every Wednesday night, used to drink wine and talk about the stock market. That's a pretty freaking dry subject to talk about on a Wednesday night, drinking wine. So I was invited along, and I met them, and they were excited to meet me because I was the trader, guy that they'd never met. And I said, "How's your trading going?" And everybody kind of looked down at their glass of wine and didn't really say very much. I said, "Well, you know, you guys making money?" And they looked down and I said, "Well, how much money did you spend on your training, your education, this seminar? How much did it cost you?" £10,000. I'm like, "Shit, £10,000, which at the time would have been like 20,000 Australian dollars. So I'm like, "Wow, that's a significant investment." And they're like, "Yeah." I said, "Well, so what's happened? How many of you got trading accounts open with money and they're doing stuff?" And they're like, again, they're looking down. One guy puts his hand up, "I got a trading account." I went, "Great, how long have you had it open?" He goes, "Oh, I've had it for about 10 years. Oh, okay, so he didn't really count. And so then I said, "Well, when did you go on your trading seminar?" Thinking they'd only been on it the weekend before because they'd been on it 6 weeks ago. I'm like, "So hold on a second, 6 weeks ago, what's the holdup?" And then it hit me. I thought, how come I've got 19 people which were on my lounge room floor trading away, making up to £2,000-£3,000 a day, some of them smoking cigarettes, drinking coffee, banging away. How come I've got those guys doing it, but all of these guys aren't doing it? And then it really hit me. And it is, of course, the simple question I then asked, which was, how many of you actually watched the guy who trained you actually trade? Did you see it? And of course, what do you think they said? Yes or no? No, they hadn't seen it. So I realized very quickly that, you know, belief is an important thing. We believe things that we see, that we have a visceral experience with. We need to see it. I realized every single person I sat with me, even if we had a pint of lager in our hands, they saw the process. They saw £3,000 in real money happen in front of them. And of course, it got them inspired to want to do something about it. So I think with that said, I want to get you guys, how many people in this room, let's say, how many people in this room think you could become a millionaire trading the currency markets? If it took you like a couple of hours a day, by show of hands, how many people think? Everybody up, show of hands. How many people here don't do it, have never traded the currency markets? Okay, that's most of you. And the thing I learned very quickly on is the difference between thinking we can do something and believing we can do something. And they are two very different things, and often we get confused that they're the same, and they're not. Because belief tends to follow, action tends to follow what the initial belief was. And what I learned very quickly, if I could just write this up here for you guys, is that there was a guy in the States called Bob Diltz, and he said, look, belief... Bob Diltz was an American psychologist way back in the mid-70s, and he said, look, things start with belief, and then the next thing that follows is action, and the thing that follows after that is resources leveraged. Resources leveraged, and then we run into results, and that feeds back into belief. And he said, look, if somebody is not doing the thing they really want to be doing and not getting the results from, it's because they have what's called a negative belief. They don't really believe it. So the action they take is a lot or a little. Hello? Hey, hello? A little or a lot? A little. So the action's a little. The resources leverage, you want to write this down, is your time and your money. how much time and money you devote to something. These are often very important resources that we assign to something that we give great credence to. And if the resources leveraged, your time and your money is a little, then of course the results themselves are going to be small. And then importantly, and this is the important thing, this belief that feeds back, or the result that feeds back into the initial belief, and it always tends to support it. Always tends to support it. So if they didn't really think much was going to happen, they didn't do very much, they didn't use much of their time and their money, the results weren't great. And of course, the initial belief is supported. So the spiral continues to be negative. Does that make sense, everybody? Yes or no? Conversely, we find that if the belief is strong and positive, I was an IT guy walking onto a trading floor with 38 traders, half of them are women, half of them are men, all of them punching away on the currency markets, making some of them in excess of £150,000 every couple of weeks. My belief was it built strong that there could be money made in the money markets. Yes or no? Absolutely. And I didn't have any experience prior, but that didn't stop me getting hold of a laptop, installing some software, putting a little bit of money into it, and cracking on with it and getting some results. As soon as I did that, did it support the original belief? The answer to that question is, of course it did. So, I believe if you're going to go somewhere, you need to figure out where you currently are. And if anyone in this room says, do you know what? If I could give 3 or 4, 5, maybe 10 hours a week to something, and it could bring me in excess of $50,000, $60,000, $70,000, $80,000 a month, would it be worth it? Yes or no? I think the answer to most people to that question is yes. And obviously, years after that, that can grow exponentially. But if giving it a bit of time can add $10,000 or $20,000 to your back pocket every week or 2 weeks, it's worth doing. The question then becomes is, well, I'm not doing it, so how do I get to doing it? And a portion of it is the mechanics, what needs to be doing. And I'm going to talk to you about that in a second. But before you can get to the mechanics, the actual physicality of doing it, because I promise you, that part is simple. The mindset of getting yourself to actually do it and make it an important thing to do comes, in my opinion, from the belief. Does that make sense? And so why I say that is because I believe that every single person I've ever trained who's gone on to become a very successful individual at this and make a whole bag load of money has done it because they watched someone, either me or one of the traders on my trading floor, trade live and see what's possible. Does that make sense to everybody? Yes or no? So let's start the session off the right way. I'd like to show you a live trade, if that's okay, so you can see how much is possible and what kind of, I'm going to talk through it, I'm going to kind of annotate it, and to really get into the guts of this straight off the bat so you guys get a good sense of what this game is all about. Does that make sense for everybody, yes or no? Would that be good? Excellent. Yeah, I just want to jump straight into content, if that's okay. Now, for some of you, it's going to be a little technical, but don't let that put you off. I will explain as much as I can. Let me tell you this something. This is easy. And some people tell you trading isn't easy. Trading is a nightmare if you don't know what to do. Trading is easy if you know what to do and when to do it. And that's how the best traders in the world operate. I learned very quickly that good traders, the ones that make all the money, don't sit there in front of trading screens scratching their head asking questions like, is the market at support or resistance? What should we do? I think the Fed is speaking. They don't do all of that. The best traders in the world who make the best money know exactly what to do and when to do it based on certain signals. And they only do two or three things a day, and that's where all the money comes from. So I'm going to play a video, but before I do that, I need to find the clicker. Ah, here it is. I'm going to play a video which illustrates how I made £19,000 in 4 minutes. Would that be worth watching, yes or no? So we're going to jump to that video now, and I'm going to pause throughout parts of the video so you guys get a real sense of how I did it and what the game is really all about. So, okay, let's jump to the video now. Okay, first of all, this video I'm going to teach you is called a pivot trade.
Okay, so we're looking at a pivot breakout now on British pound against the US dollar. Notice how the British pound against the US dollar has ranged throughout this, what we call R.5 to R1. And as British pound now breaks through here, as it's now doing, we're going to take a long position, which means we're going to buy British pound, and we're going to look to run up here. And
that okay, pause there. Excellent. Oh, these AV guys here are geared. Okay. It's great having a good AV team. Now, what you're seeing there is a chart of the British pound against the US dollar. Everybody clear about that, yes or no? Yeah. So, and this is one of the most widely traded currency pairs. And what you're seeing is, if you notice, you'll see a blue line, then you'll see all this like red, you see the little red and green bars going up, and that's just the price on the day. Each one of those bars is about 5 minutes in length, and it's moving up and down. Now, you'll see as the price, see the price has kind of ranged in that between those two red lines, those two red horizontal lines. Those red lines are called pivots. What are they called? Pivots. And they are used by floor traders and prop traders, and the most prolific traders on the planet use those lines, because those lines tell us where the market is likely to find a ceiling and where the market's likely to find a floor. So they're quite useful, because if the market penetrates, goes through those lines, and then confirms that it's gone through, it's likely to run at least another 20 points upwards. Please write that down. So when markets go through a pivot line, they make about another 20 points. Now you might think, well, what is important about 20 points? Well, if I said to you, look, for every point you made $1,000, would that be useful to have $20,000 in a short space of time? Yes or no? Would it be useful to have $200 in a short space of time? The answer is still yes. So regardless of where you start, having 20 points is still 20 points. The size of the 20 points is obviously defined by the trading account that you might have. Okay, so we're now going to see what happens as the market penetrates through that line, and you're going to see me put the trade on the trading account. Now, I will trade this at £1,000 a point. So we can continue playing the video now, see what happens.
The R2, we're just really going to look to take 20 points. We're going to have a 20-point stop, and we're going to have a 20-point target. So simple 20-pointer. Let's go place that trade. Okay, so it looks like we have a cable at about 61.68. We're going to go 1,000 a point. We have a 20-point stop. That's 20,000. And yeah, we'll happily buy that. Good. And we can see here, that's good. We're sort of 1,000 a point. Average price, our current price here is 161.89. We can see we're up 1,000. And the trade is moving. Now, we're happy to take that the 20-point stop. That's about 20,000 risk on a 2 million account. That's 1%, so we're happy with that. We are in the trade. We'll now wait for the position to see if we have some movement. And if we have movement, you'll see it move quite rapidly. So we have a couple of points. We have 3,000, 4,000, 5,000.
Oh, gosh, you guys are good. I got to tell you, this is like the best AV team I've ever worked with. Give the AV team a little round of applause for being just so good. They are very good. Okay, now, important learning coming up, so get ready with your notes. Here it comes. Here's your first real good nugget of really cool information. Foreign exchange trading is where all the money is made by the big, big fish in the world. Please understand that. So we're talking today about trading the currency markets. I've been trading the currency markets for 15 years now, and I've got to tell you, this is where the big cash is made, and there's a bunch of reasons for that, which I'm going to explain as we get on in our little session here. But what I want you to know is the dynamic of trading foreign exchange is different from trading the share market or the stock market. How many people here have traded the stock market before? Quick show of hands. Hello? Put them up there. Let me see who you are. Okay, so there's a good smattering. And you know, you guys are kind of centrally incentivized in this country to trade the share market, or at least have a discretionary interest in the share market, different from other places in the world. The currency markets, the foreign exchange markets, is the trading of one currency, obviously, against the other. And there's an interesting dynamic that takes place. Just watch this on the board. If we could jump, actually, to the video camera so you can see me, and then we'll go back to the other video, if that's not too hectic. Yeah, brilliant. So, what I've done here, what I want you to notice is we saw these little bars do this, and I said, okay, if that's not too confusing, I said I was going to buy it. Does everybody remember that? Yes. And I wanted it to run 20 points. Do you guys remember that, folks? Yes or no? And it's 1,000 points. I want to try and make a quick 20 grand. Now, I know, as a currency trader, that there's something that happens in the currency world, the foreign exchange trading world, that doesn't really happen so much in the stock trading world. And it's called the concept of market testing. So please write in your notes, market testing, underline, market testing. What is market testing? This is one of the biggest secrets in the currency world that the average guy on the street is just unaware of, for good reason. Now, what is it? Well, as the market goes through here, something happens which causes the market to fall. And stock traders, i.e. people who have been trading stocks, find this phenomenon completely freaking scary. because they're like, what the hell is happening? They're in the trade, and then all of a sudden, as soon as they've gotten into the trade, the market starts to push against them, and they don't understand why. What's happening here is the currency market, 85% of which is controlled by the large institutional interbanks, all they're doing is they are market testing. Now, what does market testing mean? Well, market testing means as soon as the market's gone through one of these key pivot levels, the big guys, the big market makers, want to test to see if this level is now strong enough to support the price continuing to move upwards. Does that make sense? Yes or no? And the only way you can test that, of course, is to sell it, to let it come off a little bit, to test back and push and test to see if the market will hold that level. Because the market makers, they're the big guys and the interbank and the institutions and the prop traders, these are the guys, remember this is a $4 trillion market a day. They want to know there's enough buying pressure behind it to continue the propulsion of the market upwards. Do I make sense, folks? Yes or no? Good. So when this thing happens here, and your trade that you've lovingly placed on at $50 per pip or whatever, starts to pull back, and you see you've gone into profit a little bit, and then the market starts to, what do you think, how do you think people feel? Do you think they feel a little bit freaked out, yes or no? Yes, they do. And it's the freaking out which kind of pushes them out of the trade. So I'm going to show you that as we go on, but I want you to be aware of it. It's called market testing, and it causes a bit of a pullback. Now, with trading and anything else in life, please write this down, anticipation is the mother of all skill. Anticipation is the mother of all skill. In other words, if you know what's coming, or you've got a good understanding, a good prevision of what's likely to happen, you can anticipate it, you know how to react to it when it comes. If you don't know what's coming, if you have zero anticipation, just blind faith, then what generally would happen is you're going to react in an emotional state which is probably not going to serve the outcome. Does that make sense to everybody? Yes or no? But if you can anticipate what's coming, you can relax and do what you need to do in order to get to where you need to go. Can we jump back to the video we paused, and then we'll carry on, please? Thanks.
Expected to pull a little bit back off that level, bounce, and then continue moving. Notice here as I extend out the line here, we've got the trade registered here. Current price 61.70. P&L is 2,000. Now 3,000. So this is going to move around. The deal price on the trade, as we can certainly see here, was 61.68, and the trade is steadily moving along. And all we're looking really now to do is pull 20 points. Now the way we'll do this trade is on this platform, I'll hit close deal in a second, which will then bring up the trade ticket. It's a lumpy trade, a thousand British pounds a point. So that means that we need to make sure that the brokers are aware that I'm trying to exit the trade. So I'll hit close deal, and it will allow me to bring up the deal ticket. And then I'll literally just hit close, or I'll hit obviously buy to close, sell to close my long position. So we can see this is that pullback I was talking about. It's coming back a little bit.
Okay, so it's pulling back. Does that make sense, everybody? Yes or no? Hello? Yeah. So now we've been up to £4,000 or £5,000. Now £4,000 or £5,000 is like $7,000 or $8,000 or $9,000 for a few. I mean, how many people would be quite happy just to have taken the $7,000 or $8,000 or $9,000 and gone off and done something else for the day? Yes or no? Yes? Come on, I mean, if for 30 seconds, $9,000 for 30 seconds, that's not a bad day's work. Would you guys agree with that? Yes or no? However, now it's all gone. There's nothing. Now, I don't care how long I've been trading. Do you guys know the concept of a tell? You know, when someone says, oh, I don't know, they've just got a tell. You can tell that there's a flinch, or they maybe do something with their ear, or they say something, and that's a tell that they have. Do you all understand what I mean by that when someone says they've got a tell? Yes or no? So I know my own personal nervous tell is when I go, I just have that. For some reason, I go, that's my nervous tell. And the reason I say it is just because obviously I've played this video back a little bit, and I notice my own nervous tell on this video as this is now bottom out. Because, of course, if this trade wasn't going to work out, now would be the time where it would not work out, and I'd have to pull the trade off the table. Does that make sense? So I'm obviously, in this moment, I want it to do what I hope it's going to do, which is bounce back here, test, and then run forward. But let's listen to see if we can hear my tell, if we now continue playing the video and see what happens.
Now just testing that level. What I was expected to do would be bounce and immediately now start to move back upwards, and that would be my expectation. So again, I'm up a point, 1,000. So not a lot right now, but I expect this bounce, and it's now starting to bounce upwards. So back to 3,000, 4,000. And really now just waiting to close the deal. When we get over the 20 point mark where I should be able to see about £20,000 of profit, I'm literally going to start to hit the close deal button and pull this trade off the table. I'd expect the run around now, given that it's broken now, clearly gone through that level. Here we can see it's 12,000, 13, here we are. Here we are, we're up to the 21,000 mark. So I now want to exit this trade. So I'll be now moving my mouse. See if we can hold this level. Let's close the deal here now. And see if we can lock that 20 points. So it's holding 22,000. It's not going to move any more. Let's click the close deal, and let's get this trade priced up. I'm waiting for the broker to pull my price. So you can see the price has moved around, and here I go, and it's going to hit sell at 20 points is what I'm after, which is around this level here, and we'll take the trade just about. Yeah, about here. Let's tick it up to 20. See if we can capture 20. There it is. Okay. Oh, we got 19. Okay, that's close enough. So there we are. That's how you make £19,000 in about three or four minutes.
That's it. I say you make £19,000 in 3 or 4 minutes. Good trade, folks. Yes or no?
See if we can do another one.
Thank you. Now, if we go back to PowerPoint, that'd be really cool. Okay. So now, of course, many of you won't start out with a trading account where you can do £1,000 a point. However, if you're making £200 or £2,000 in the same period of time, is that still a good start, folks? Yes or no? That's still not a bad way to go. The key here is, as we drew up here, it starts with a bit of belief. You've got to take a little bit of action. Then we've got to use some of the money, and then we've got to get some results. And the fastest way to do that, please write this down. The fastest way, if you know right now you're not doing this in current market conditions, you are missing out on the biggest boatload of money that's ever come to town. Ever come to town. Now, the reason you're not doing this is because the belief is low, because you think there may be more money to lose in doing this. The quickest way to shift from one set of beliefs, i.e., yeah, I think I could do it, maybe I could be a bit, to actually doing it and knowing you can do it, is by changing the time you spend with the right people. So shifting some people into your life who do this is the quickest way to get there. Certainly I found that. So want to become good at this, want to spend an hour or two a day, want to target, and by the way, please write this down. My minimum target for you is about 100 points a week. So 100 points a week is where we start beginners off as the initial trading target. So if you're hitting 100 points a week and you're trading at about $10 a point, you're making 1,000 a week. It's not massive money to start with, but I still consider $1,000 a week is still pretty good money. Would you guys agree with that, yes or no? And then from there we build. I run trading floors in Johannesburg, in London, in Sydney, in the US. I can tell you now, in current market conditions, which for all other reasons are hectic for currency trading, they are incredible, absolutely incredible. We have traders on our trading floors now with their trading targets move from 400 to 1,200 pips in these market conditions. That means you've got 24 and 25-year-old guys who started trading 2 years ago looking to make between 10 and 25,000 pounds a week. They wouldn't be doing that in any other kind of job. And all they're doing is executing on the very same trading strategies I took from the trading floors I used to work on when I was a similar age. So let's jump into why do we trade foreign exchange. First of all, let me tell you this. Currency trading is what millionaire traders do. And the reason for that is it's the most liquid market in the world. This market is $4 trillion US a day. What does that mean to you? Well, I'll tell you what it means to you. If you're somebody who wants to get rich in an asset class, you want to pick an asset class that does not get more expensive the bigger you get. If you were trading the stock market and you got bigger and bigger and your trade started getting bigger and bigger, would it cost you more to trade, yes or no? And the answer to that question is yes, of course it would, because you'd have to pay more to get more stock, because there's stock at different price levels. when you're trading the currency market, $4 trillion, you can put €500 million in the market and take it out in a split second. It's going to cost you the same as if you put $10,000 in the market and took $10,000 out. So this is why traders of size use this market. Now, let me tell you something else. Please write this down. Currency trading is low-risk trading for one very important reason. Currency trading is low-risk trading for one important reason. Liquidity is precision. Liquidity is precision. In other words, the more liquid a marketplace that you're in, the more likely it's going to do the thing that it should do. What does that mean? Well, stock markets, can they be manipulated, yes or no? Easily. Stock markets and illiquid stocks can easily be manipulated by a few small people. Three or four people who've got deep pockets can manipulate a stock market. A currency market is $4 trillion, cannot be as equally manipulated, and therefore it makes it safer for you to trade in that environment. Now, with $1,000, you can control over $100,000, so of course you can make your money work very hard. And if you consider the New York Stock Exchange is a swimming pool, then by some kind of contrast, the currency markets is the equivalent of 9 Atlantic Oceans, so it's much, much bigger. It trades 24 hours a day, which means you can trade whenever you want. Some of you will trade and want to trade in the morning for an hour. Some will want to trade in the afternoon. Some will want to trade in the evening. It's open all day long, 5 hours a day. The problem with the stock market is it closes during the day. And if a market closes during the day, that creates risk. Think of it like this. If I can just jump to the video screen, to the pad over here. What happens when you're holding stocks? Here's your biggest problem if you trade stocks. Here it's Monday, here's Tuesday, here's Wednesday, here's Thursday, and here's Friday. Now, here goes the stock. You buy the stock here, and by Tuesday it moves up to here. Something happens overnight on Wednesday. What happens to a stock market every evening? It does what? It closes. Well, if the stock market closes on Tuesday night and some profits announcement comes out, and you decided you wanted to get in here, whenever you place a trade in any market, there are three things that you've got to place. Let's capture what they are. The first thing is your entry. So we call this your entry price. This is where you get in. Let's say this is your entry price and it's here. That's the first thing you do. The second thing you want to place is something we call a stop loss. And this says, this is where I get out if things go wrong, which of course they can. And the third thing we might have is a target. A target price. This is the profit we're looking to make. And let's say it's up here somewhere. Well, everything's going well. You bought here on Monday. It's looking good. By Tuesday, it's up a little bit. And then something happens on Wednesday, early in the morning, a big profits announcement, or something happens abroad, and the market's closed. But when the market opens up, the market is now down here on Wednesday morning. The market has jumped from here all the way down to here. Scurriedly, you jump onto the phone, you phone your broker and you say, what's going on? And the broker says, oh, I don't know, there's something happened overnight, the stock's trading a lot lower. And you say, yeah, but my stop loss was in here at 94.50. I want to get out at 94.50. I got in at 95. I want out at 94.50. And the broker says, yeah, I'm afraid the stock right now is down here at 9100. And you say, yeah, I understand that it's at 9100, but I put my stop loss in at 9450. I want to come out at 9450. I came out at 9450, didn't I? What does a stockbroker say? No. So we said, no, it's at 9100 now, so what do you want to do? He said, well, I wanted to come out at 9450, where I said I wanted to come out. He said, yeah, I know, but stuff happened overnight. It's now at 9100. What do you want to do? And you say, it's now moved down to 1999. What do you want to do now? And of course you say, get me out, and you take the loss. And this happens when you're a stock trader all the time. It's called gapping. Gapping. And if you've ever traded stocks before, particularly in Australia, because it's more of an illiquid market here than anywhere else, it's a nightmare. This can be a big nightmare. This doesn't happen so much in the currency markets because the currency markets are always open overnight. If something was to happen overnight, it would trade through where your stop loss was and take you out so you retain your profit. Does that make sense, everybody? Yes or no? So that's one of the reasons we use currency. If we can jump back to the PowerPoint, that's one of the reasons we use currency as a tool, because it means there's less risk out there for us. Now, let's look at some essential things here. Most of you are already currency traders. How many people here have been on holiday before? Okay, good. So you know that, for example, let's say you're in England, which is obviously where I'm from, and you exchange £100 and you get $155. You go off on your big US tour, and when you come back, you realize that you receive £110 for every $155 you exchange. You're like, hold on a sec, I've made £10. How did that happen? I was on holiday, I came back, and I'd made £10. Well, unbeknownst to you, when you were on holiday, of course, let's just click that one on. You left on the 1st, Wednesday, and you didn't intend on coming back till the 24th. And as far as you're concerned, you were on holiday for a few weeks. But what was happening in the background, of course, is that the currency markets, the British pound against the US dollar, was exactly doing that. It was falling. The British pound was falling against the US dollar. So essentially, you were earning more money, unbeknownst to you. Well, then imagine every £1,000 by the same token you could convert into 100 or 1,100 pounds. You'd make a profit of 100 pounds. Well, imagine every £10,000 you could convert into 11,000 pounds. You'd make a profit of 1,000 pounds. And this is specifically what foreign exchange, forex traders, this is what we do. It's purely the process of buying and selling money. But instead of waiting sort of 20 or 24 days to get the profit, we do it within minutes or we do it within hours. And in this market, under these market conditions, with the leverage and the way we can manage the risk, the income can be fantastic. Now, what else drives the market? Well, of course, fear and greed drives the market. I'm just going to play you a video now, and this kind of tells you what's happening. And then I'm going to show you a strategy right here now in this seminar that if you're fast with a pen and paper, you can use straight away next week, and it will make you between 100 and 180 points a week. That's $1,000 to $1,800 a week. Would you guys be interested in learning that, yes or no? Yeah, okay, cool. Now, you're going to be fast with the pens because I'm going to give you all the rules. But let me show you what's happening first, and then I'll give you the game. So here comes the video.
There are all kinds of technical explanations for stock market crashes. But at root, it's all about herd psychology. In a bull market, that's when share prices are rising, even the smartest investors can succumb to what the former chairman of the American Federal Reserve, Alan Greenspan, famously called irrational exuberance. But when the herd changes direction, sometimes in reaction to nothing more than a change in the wind, their mood can also change from euphoria to gloom. The herd stampedes.
One cow gets scared, and that fear just translates to the whole herd, and they all take off. And the rest of them don't know why they're scared. They just feel that fear, and they run. Fear overwhelms all rational thinking. Until it's over.
In market jargon, the buyers have turned into sellers, the bulls into bears.
Despite the zoological imagery, the point is that markets are mirrors of the human psyche. Like Homo sapiens, they're prone to mood swings, from greed to fear. They can suffer from depression, and sometimes they can experience complete breakdowns. That happens rather more often than some financial theories would lead you to expect, but not so often that we're ever quite ready for the next breakdown.
Okay, cool. So, what that means is there's a lot of fear in the market. Please write this down. Fear in Forex trading is your greatest friend. Fear is your greatest friend. All the money in the currency markets is made out of fear. That's where the big cash is. I'm going to show you that strategy, I promised you. Before I do, let me just show you this chart here. This is what a bar chart looks like. And then I'm going to get busy on the whiteboard here in a second and show you exactly what we do to make ourselves what we call a few quid every week. So on the left-hand side, you're seeing a green bar. And notice there are four elements to the bar. There's a high and the low. And then the left-hand handle is where the market opens and the right-hand handle is where it closes. Can everybody see that, folks? Yes or no? Yeah, and the left-hand one is the buyer bar, and we call that, a buyer bar or an up bar. And notice you can see on the left-hand side there, it could be one of many different time frames. That bar could be measuring hours or minutes or days or weeks or whatever you like. But the point is, the bar, the four elements of it, tells us what's happened in that session, in that period of time. So the green bar tells us that whatever happened there, there were really more buyers there than there were sellers. Conversely, the one to the right is the seller bar, and you can see it opened high, went up a bit, then it fell, and it stayed down. Does everybody see the fact that it stayed down? Because the right-handed handle is where it closed, and that stayed low. Everybody got basic concepts of what a bar looks like, folks? Yes or no? Now, there's something that happens. I'm just going to jump on the notepad here. There's something that happens about three times a week in the currency markets, and every time it happens, you can make yourself about 60 points every time it happens. And it happens about three times, so there's about 180 points to be made. Would you like to know how it's done? About four people want to know. What about the rest of you guys? You guys up for it, yes or no? Okay, so let's have a look. Pens at the ready. We are looking at three currency pairs. Ready? They are the euro against the US dollar. That's one. We're looking at the British pound against the US dollar. That's the second one. Or we're looking at the dollar against the Swiss franc. They're the three currency pairs that this works with. Now, we're looking at this at about between 5 o'clock in the morning, Greenwich Mean Time, so this is London, between 5 o'clock in the morning and about 9 o'clock in the morning. So that block of 4 hours from five in the morning till about nine, this is where all the money's made. And what we look for is, let's say, for example, this little bar here is the 5 o'clock bar, that's the 5 a.m. Is the bar going up or is the bar going down? It's going up, isn't it? It opens here, and it goes up, and it closes here. That's 5 o'clock. Then let's say 6 o'clock looks pretty much like this. This is the 6 a.m. bar. Does that? And let's say 7 does that, and that's going up a bit too. So, and let's say the currency we're looking at is the euro here against the US dollar, the euro against the US dollar. Now, one would consider it's early morning, it's the European session, the market's up a little bit, and 7 o'clock it's gone up, and it's come back down. Now, how many people here would consider the market is just going up? That's what's happening. Quick show of hands. How many people here think the market's going down? One or two people? How many people here don't know? Good, okay. So this is what we're looking for. You just watched a video. Did you see the video, the part of the video with the Americano in the 10-gallon hat? And he was saying that fear overrides all rational thinking. Do you guys remember that part? Write this down. Fear overrides all rational thinking. This is an amazing thing if you want to make money. Because people in their million loads do things irrationally practically every single day. And if you know what they're doing, you can monetize it very quickly. So we look for this. What's happening here, if I can just zoom on that bit there, that's perfect. Now, this means the market opened here, it went up, which to all intents and purposes would mean the market is rallying, it's moving upwards, but something else happened. It then came all the way back. Do you remember in the video when the herd was moving in one direction, the herd changed direction, yes or no? This is the changing of direction intra-bar. Each of these bars is 1 hour long. It's 5 o'clock, 6 o'clock, 7 o'clock. This goes up and then it falls. And now it's here and it's closed here. It's still an up bar because it's higher than where it opened. So it still makes it an up bar. And to the uninitiated, it looks like things are still moving up. This is not the case. Things are not moving up now. Here is fear in the bar. It went up and it fell all the way down, leaving a long tail on the bar. The next thing that happens for us is we draw a line underneath the bottom of that bar. And then when the 8 o'clock bar opens, we expect this to happen. And if this happens, remember I said to you we do three things, three orders. What did we say? The first one was called a what? Entry. Do you remember that? What was the second one called? Stop loss, brilliant. So we had the entry, so we would enter here, entry. We're gonna put a stop loss up here. Stop loss is up here, and then we are gonna sell this market, and we are gonna expect it to do this, and we're gonna sell it, and we're gonna take 60 points. 60 points. And when we get to 60 points, we are gonna take the trade off the table. Now, when this happens in the currency markets, don't forget the currency markets run hundreds of points every day. And generally speaking, from a trading this position live, this normally runs 100 to maybe 150 points. Do we look for the 100 or the 150 points, folks? Yes or no? Absolutely not. We go for the 60. We take the quick 60 points. We sell the market here, which means we short it, which means we are betting on them, if you like. We're betting on the market falling. And if it breaks through here, there's a very, very high chance it will fall quite a long way. And we'll take the 60 points off the table. We limit our risk to here. This is where we place our stop loss. And we'll do this between 3 and 4 times a week. And that, in short order, is how you make 180 points a week. You guys up for that? Yes or no? Useful strategy? Please write that down. Now, there's a couple of other things we need to know to make that happen, so I'm going to go through those as we get into the session here. But that is called the high test euro. It happens on the British pound against the US dollar, happens on the euro against the US dollar, and it happens on the dollar against the Swiss franc. And the reason that happens is there's offset balancing happening between those major currencies that happens in the early European session to kind of ratify what happened the day before. And so as traders, we do not sit there for 8 hours a day scratching our head, waiting for an opportunity to present themselves. I personally don't believe that's the way to make money. There's a few things some of the best proprietary traders in the world do, and that is they look for certain signals, and they know, most importantly, when those signals are going to occur. And when those signals do occur, they simply put those trades on and take the money, and then they walk away. Does that make sense? I personally believe anyone in this room could do this at any time. I think the key to making money trading is to make sure that you marry up your time frame availability with what works well then. Does that make sense? When I have traders, when people come and train with us, whether it's in Australia here or South Africa or in London, wherever you are in the world, we train you and then we sit with you with a trader and we go, okay, Bob, when are you free? And Bob goes, what? Well, how much money do you want to make, Bob? Bob says, well, I want to make $10,000 a month. Okay, Bob, how much money you got to start with? And we figure, he says, well, I got this amount. Great, when are you free? And he says, well, I can be free whenever. I said, no, Bob. If you can be when you're free whenever, Bob will never be free at the right time. Does that make sense? So we figure out when Bob free. Bob says, well, I've got to run the kids to school at 7 in the morning, 8 in the morning, that's my job. But after that, I'm available at 4 in the afternoon and 9 o'clock at night. Well, there's something that happens at 4 o'clock in the afternoon. Something happens at 4:30 in the afternoon every single day. And if Bob's around at that time, would it make sense for Bob to then put that trade on and manage that? Yes or no? It makes no sense for Bob just to pop on there at 10 o'clock in the day when there's nothing really happening and hope he's going to scratch his head and make some money trading. So this is all about knowing what to do and, most importantly, when to do it. If I could just jump to the next slide. Okay. So, for example, the game here is all about pips, collecting points. In the trading world, in the foreign exchange trading world, we look at 4 decimal places. So you look at the British pound against the US dollar, it's 155.70. The real important bit here is the 70. That's the bit we care about. So if you imagine the British pound, we bought it at 155.70. We'd really look to sell it at 155.90, let's say. And if we did that, how many pips have we made? How many? 20, that's right. And if we were trading at $20 a pip, we'd make $400. Good. Now, let me teach you the important bit right now. This is key and critical. So again, get ready with your notes. You now know how to make money trading a little euro position every day. Let me teach you how not to lose the money, because this is important. Traders who are successful say this. Well, actually, let me tell you what losers say first. Losers say, how much money can I make? Please just make a note of that. It might sound like a silly thing for you to write down right now, but just go with me on this for a second. Write down, how much money can I make? When a human being asks their brain a question, does the brain always try and answer the question that's posed to it in some way, yes or no? Yes. And see, when we ask the question, how much money can I make, the brain tries to answer that by saying, well, I can make as much money as I probably put on the trade. And what that ends up happening is that leads to overtrading and gambling. People who make money consistently trading, and a lot of it, ask the following question: how much money can I afford to lose? That's right. So let me show you that as an example. The first rule of trading is to keep the risk to 1%. What percent? 1%. So take a look at the following example we've got going up here, and you'll see this again is the famous British pound against the US dollar. You'll see the British pound is hitting up against a red line we've drawn on the chart there, and that line is called a line of resistance. What's it called? A line of? excellent resistance. And you'll see the market then falls away. I'll point my laser pen up here if you can all see that. So this is hits there, fails. Hits there, fails. Hits there, fails. And it'll fall away. And then you'll notice the market turns around at this point and rallies. And as the market breaks up through this old line of resistance, and it's now above the line of resistance, we've cheekily changed the name from resistance to a line of support. And notice I've changed it and we've made it green. And now the market is trading above that line of support, and off it goes. Now, here's what we don't do. We don't ever buy the extension. So this, watch what's happening here. See the market's rallying and see how the market's broken through this line? Generally, your amateur traders would look to buy the breakout. So they would want to get into this position here. They buy it here. Let me just zoom this in a little bit here. That's a bit better. Good. So your amateur would try and buy it here. Do you see that? They'd say, oh, the British pound is hitting new highs. It's breaking out. Let's buy it. The problem with that is what happens immediately after it's broken out? The market does what? It falls. Do you remember earlier on I was talking about that there's a dynamic that happens in the currency markets where as soon as markets break out, they do something, they test. Do you guys remember that concept, yes or no? Of course, it's what happens in currency trading. It doesn't happen in stock trading, it's different. In currency trading, the major market players, they test the market. So as soon as it breaks out, we don't buy it here at all. We wait for it to come back, test, and then we get into the market. Is everyone clear on that, yes or no? And so then, let's say we decide we're going to get into it somewhere around here. Notice these long tails are the opposites of the ones we saw before. So we're looking for this as an entry. So the first question we have is, okay, well, let's figure out, A, where do we get in? Please write this down. This is the anatomy of making a successful trade, the anatomy of making a successful trade. I teach this to traders, hedge fund traders, prop traders, trading floor man, all over the world, same technique, here it comes. So we enter the trade on the pullback. So write that down. We enter on the pullback. That's where the market's broken through that level, and it's then falling or testing or pulling back. And it's right at that point where it's like, is it going to fall or is it going to bounce? Does that make sense? And we're looking for a confirmed signal that says, yeah, it's bouncing. That's because it goes down, it's pulling back up. It comes back down, pulls back up. And when we have a double confirmation on that, that tells us we can take this and we can now buy this. Does that make sense, everybody? Yes or no? Yeah. Now, that's the first step. Step two is we've got to figure out, well, that's all well and good. It still may completely go wrong. Is that true too? So we've got to imagine this thing could go wrong, and if it does, we've got to figure out where the hell we're getting out. And here is where we place the stop loss. Notice where the stop loss is placed. The stop loss goes underneath the line of support. It doesn't go up here. Bad area. It must go underneath here to be protected in case something goes wrong. Does that make sense to everybody? Yes or no? And then all we do is step three, we now measure the distance between where we get in on that pullback and where that stop loss goes. And the distance between those two points is called the risk. And the risk here is 50 points. So now we know we're risking 50 points. Please write that down. The risk here is 50 points. We've got to figure out, well, so what? What is that? How do I use that information? Here's how we use it. Whatever is in your trading account, we multiply that by 1%. So if you have $10,000 in your trading account, which is my starting point, we know 1% of 10,000 is 100, which means whatever happens, we cannot afford to lose more than $100 on any trade we place. Does that make sense, everybody? Yes or no? That means if the trading account was now $9,000, how much could we afford to lose? 90. If the trading account moves up to $15,000, how much can we afford to lose? 150. Do you understand? So you dynamically change how much you're willing to risk based on the size of the account at all times. Important credo of successful trading. So we know it's 1%. So the simple math here is we take 1% of the account, which we said was £100 of a $10,000 account, and we then divide it by the risk on the trade, which in this case was 50. And we now know that the trade size is $2. So importantly, the trade we placed here, if we had a $10,000 account, was only $2. That means every point that market moves up, we stand to make $2 per point. Is everybody clear on that, yes or no? See, this is what we focus on. Professionals focus on not how much I'm going to make. Because if you're making a profit, it will take care of itself. The only bit you need to focus your attention on is what happens if it goes wrong. This is what we call the power of negative thinking, if you like. We manage the game from, if it goes wrong, what do I do? Because there's a good chance it could go wrong as well. Does that make sense to everybody? We look at the power of negative thinking. We say, look, my negative expectation is this is going to go wrong. How do I limit my downside? And in doing that, regardless of the fact this trade makes $800, that's not the important part. The important part is whatever happens on this trade, the maximum I'm going to lose here is $100. People think if I bet big, I'm going to win big. That is completely incorrect. If you bet big, you're going to get wiped out. If you lose 50% of your account, you need to make 100% just to get back to where you started. So we always manage the downside risk and we keep it to 1%. Now, there's two other important rules I want to give you, which is when we enter the trade, we don't want to enter the trade when it's noisy. So please write this down. We enter trades when they are quiet and the bars are small. When they're quiet and the bars are small. I'll illustrate that in a second. And where we place the stop loss, if you remember from the example I've shown you, stop losses go underneath levels, and they go in places where the chart is nice and quiet. And so these are the real basic and core principles, but they're critical. So what does that mean? Let's put it all together. Well, imagine, for example, a market looks like this. This is where your amateur gets into the market, notice. Why? Well, if you look at the bottom here, this is where it's boring and it's quiet and nothing much is happening, so people are uninspired to get in. But oh, all of a sudden, the market starts to move up, and people say, oh, it's up 20 cents. Then they say, it's up 30 cents, we better get in. The reason they're getting in is because they're being driven by two important emotional forces. These are, write these down, excitement and social proof. Excitement and social proof. These will drag human beings into trades because they don't like the concept of missing out. Nobody wants to miss out. Nobody wants to miss the boat. Everybody wants to make sure they're there capturing the profit. So what's happening is they're excited and they're getting pulled in. Now what happens? Well, then the market side tracks along. What do you think is going to happen next? It's going to fall, and this is what happens. And of course, the painful exit happens around here. This happens every single day across markets all over the world. Now, let's just think about what's happening here. What if the market is $4 trillion US dollars in size? What is causing it to move up? Is it big players or is it little players? It's big players, isn't it? Big players are causing that market to move up. Who is trying to get out of the position here? Where these guys are getting in, who is trying to exit at this point? It's the big guys. The big guys got in down here when it was quiet, and the big guys are trying to get out up here. It's the little guys who have got excited by what the big guys are doing that effectively are trading against them. And when that happens, they lose out. Does that make sense? So let me just recap quickly because I want to make sure you guys have got some really good notes here. First of all, we said the maximum amount you should risk on a trade vintage. One, excellent. We said if you enter the trade, the bars on the chart should be big or small? Small. And we said the stop loss should go in a place on the chart which is noisy or quiet? Quiet. Good. And we also said, you know, when we get into a trade, we're waiting for a pullback, a bounce, rather than getting in on an extension or some excitement. Does that make sense to everybody so far? Yes or no? Are you making some good notes? Is it useful so far? Okay, I'm good, 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 good. Then the jet lag's worth it. Right, fair enough. The question I have is, will you actually do this? Are you focused on cost or opportunity? Let me talk to you about this for a second. I now have the interesting life of spending a lot of my life on airplanes, traveling around the world, talking to big groups like this about making money. And what I've found is the mechanics of making money is completely the easy part. It's the psychology, it's the mind stuff behind the making money that's the important bit. And what I've learned, I can tell you a quick story. I was on an airplane with a guy by the name of, have you guys heard of a guy called T. Harv Eker? Yes or no? Do you guys know him? T. Harv Eker, write this down, he's interesting. He wrote a book called Secrets of the Millionaire Mind. And I met him on an aeroplane. We were speaking at the same gig. I didn't know I was going to be speaking at the same gig as him. And we meet 35,000 feet above Singapore, and we start talking. We decide we figure out we both speak at the same gig. We both got really friendly. You know what it's like when you meet someone you've never met before, but you know you're going to get on well with them. And we were talking about the mechanics of wealth and why some people make a lot of money and other people don't. And I want to do an exercise with you that he taught me. He said to me, Greg, he said, let me tell you this. Give me 5 minutes with anybody, and I will tell you how rich they're going to be for the rest of their life. Do you think that sounds interesting? Imagine that, 5 minutes. I was like, shit, man, you got to teach me that. Come on, come out with it. So he goes, right. He goes, well, because of this point, so we're really getting into it. I'm talking about trading. I'm saying, oh, I was 27 years old, how much money I'd made. I said, and I left my job. And he's like, oh, that's nothing. Listen to this. And we love this. And so suddenly we've got like six Singaporean air hostesses hanging around us. Like, I want to play the game. He goes, okay, we're going to play this like money game. And so we started talking about the psychology of wealth and why certain people are rich and certain people are poor and how come academic people often are very poor and not rich. We didn't get into the whole shit, you know, really going at it. And he said, well, I can tell you anybody how rich they're going to be for the rest of their life, and I have to ask them two questions. Can I ask you guys the questions? We'll do it for fun. You guys up for that? Yes or no? Yeah? All right. So the first question is this. He said, what people think they think about money is not necessarily how they feel. And he said, one of the things I learned is that, please write this down. This is so cool. People don't do as they think. People don't do as they think. People do as they feel. People don't do as they think. People do as they feel. So I said, okay, come on, you got to tell me what you mean by that. He goes, well, he said, let's think about money, for example. He said, let me tell you, Greg, you're trading. He says, how long does it take you to make your money in the morning? I said, about an hour. I said, how much can you make in that hour? I go, £100,000? He goes, wow, that's a lot of money. I go, yeah. He goes, you got to show me how to do that. I said, I'm going to show you how to do that. He said, could anyone do that? I said, absolutely anybody can do it. I've got a 3-year-old son. I'm showing him how to do it right now. Seriously, he's been on my lap since he was like 18 months old watching the screens. And he knows exactly, my son will look at the screen going, daddy, daddy, Eurotest bar, because it flashes. My poor, poor kid, right? He can't even recite poetry yet, and he's saying shit like that. Anyway, but he will be rich. So I say, God damn it. So he said, could anyone do it? I said, yeah. He goes, so why aren't more people doing it? I said, it's a great question. He says, because the shit that's going on. I said, so here's the game. Do you guys want to play the game? He says, here's what people think about wealth. I said, if I ask you this question, what do you think when I say to you having a lot of money? What does that mean? Shout out some answers. Feel free. Freedom. Whoa, here we go. Freedom. It's like Mel Gibson's in the audience. Freedom. Yeah, thanks, Mel. Toys, yeah. Keep men, women, okay. What else? Happy life, yeah. Choices, what else? Sports cars, holidays, responsibility, oh dear. Power, someone say power. Keep going, what else? Sex, all right. I always said 90% of your problems in life can be solved by writing a check, right? Is that one of them? What else? Okay, say again? And charity, good, okay, so great. So look, I mean, random selection of only the people I could hear, and I apologize, people back in the room I couldn't hear, but when you ask a group of people, random selection, what they think about having lots of money, it's freedom, choice, men, women, happiness, choices, sex, power. We could categorize all of those things as relatively good things. Yes or no? Yes or no, people? They're all pretty good. They're not negative, are they? Okay. That's what people think they think about money. Now, the second question is the important one, which is what do you remember hearing as a child growing up said to you around the subject of money? Okay, good. So the first one is money doesn't buy happiness. Keep going. Root of all evil. Doesn't grow on trees. Save it! Does anyone remember a parent saying, we can't afford it? Yes or no? Yes, we can't afford it. You've got to work hard and all that shit. Now, would you all agree that to more or lesser extent, most of those are negative statements, yes or no? And the point that Harv was then bringing up to me, he says, look, the problem is this whole concept of, we know the mechanics of making a lot of money are relatively straightforward because they're just instructions. But the doing part, actually getting yourself into a space where you want to do it, the getting of the bigger amount of wealth, often there's a lot of stuff that's going on. Children between the age of 6 and 14, excuse me, as they say, are in what's called the impressionable age. Therefore, instructions taught to them by parents, mentors, guardians, and teachers, things like, you know, rich people are mean, they're the root of all evil, money doesn't grow on trees. I mean, a lot of these things, of course, are just clearly bullshit, but because we're taking them on at such an early age, do you think we drop them off at 15, or do you think we hold on to them for a longer period of time in our lives? Do you think we hold on to them, yes or no? And that's what's going on. So people tend to be in mixed emotions around money. You know, and it's quite funny, I always think, when you look at them, and they say, you know, money can't buy you happiness. My answer to that often is, those people just don't know where to shop. My favorite is, money doesn't grow on trees. I mean, apart from this country where your money is made out of plastic, the rest of the world, where the fuck do you think paper comes from? So the point is, and if I could just jump back to the PowerPoint slides, folks, quickly, is that, and as Harv told me, he goes, in life, people, it's not that people are aiming for here and missing it, of course, they're aiming for here and hitting it. And I'm a big believer in setting a goal and then doing some things towards it. So my point is this, we may all have this list in our head of what our life should be like, being rich and wealthy and traveling the world in style and being the person you always wanted to be. That's that should list, isn't it? And then there's the must list, which says, well, I must pay my bills, go to work, eat, sleep, and that's it. Now, which list for most people, I know this high achievement room doesn't operate under the same ideals, but for most people, which list often gets more done, the one on the left or the one on the right? And it's the one on the, it's the one on the right for good reason. Why is it the one on the right always gets done? And that is because if you don't do the one on the right, you experience immediate pain. If you don't go to sleep, you're going to feel painful the next day. Anybody who's pulled an all-nighter knows exactly how that feels. If you don't eat, you're going to feel pretty lousy the next day. If you don't go to work or pay your bills, that's going to result in pretty immediate pain. However, if you don't travel the world in style tomorrow, will you experience pain? You won't. If you haven't become the person you're always supposed to be, will you feel pain tomorrow? No. And if you haven't bought your dream home and your holiday home, you're not going to experience real pain. The only time you really experience pain on the one from the left is when you have the moment of contrast, where you meet somebody you used to go to school with or used to work with, and they're achieving more of the things on the left than you are, then often that can result in feeling of pain. I believe that the answer to a lot of this stuff is setting a goal and then chunking it down into exactly what needs to be done in order to get it. So I'm going to give you my four steps of change, and I'm going to try and make you laugh while I do it. We used to run something called the 9 steps of change, and people couldn't cope with that, so we chopped it down to the 4 steps of change. And it goes over much better, and it's faster, nearly half the speed. All around the world, with the people that come on our trading programs, people we teach to make money and go off and do big things with, they all go through this process called the 4 steps of change. It's all about changing our mind around the attraction of making more money. Is it okay if I do this process with you so you can take this really valuable piece of information away with you guys today, yes or no? Okay, I'm going to tell it to you in a funny story. I'm not going to tell it to you in a story about how I made a load of money, because I think that's kind of boring. I'd like to talk to you about how I learned to fly helicopters, because this is a more fun story. So here come the steps, and I'll tell you the funny story. Step 1 is create a meaningful goal. Please write that down. Create a meaningful goal. The important word here is meaningful, so it must be written down. Meaningful means it must mean something to you. Most people's goals are other people's goals. Most people's goals are society goals, your wife or your husband's goals, your girlfriend or your boyfriend's goals, but they're not your goals. What do you want to do? Because unless you know exactly what you want, the likelihood of you getting it becomes very little. Most people you speak to in life and you ask them what they want, they don't know. So it's really important we know what we want. Now, I've got a trading floor in London, in Chelsea, on the Thames. If you know where the River Thames is, it runs right through the middle of London. Opposite my trading floor, and it's a big trading floor now, there's a big heliport, London heliport, and helicopters land there about every 10 minutes. And one of my traders on the floor says, Greg, you should fly a helicopter. What do you fly a helicopter? I said, yeah, it's something I've always been meaning to do. I should really learn how to do that. So all the boys on my floor start going, Greg, sounds like a goal, mate. Write it down. So of course, one of the guys on my whiteboard writes down Greg to be a helicopter pilot. So I pick up. So like, I have to set a good example to my team. So then I pick up the phone, and I go, I'll figure it out. So I pick up the phone, I speak to one of my best friends who's a pilot, and I said, Rich, who taught you to fly? And he went, oh, Greg, go and get yourself in a quiet room. I know exactly the guy you need to talk to. I'm like, all right. So I get in the quiet room, he goes, Greg, listen. There's this guy called Quinton Smith. But nobody calls him Quinton Smith. Everybody calls him Q. And I said, well, what's the big deal? He goes, oh, no, you don't understand. This guy's got a proper old school, like, handlebar moustache. Like, it's like proper, like, waxed handlebar moustache. He said, he's brilliant. He said, this is the guy that flew his helicopter to the South Pole. His family are old explorers, and he speaks with the most outrageous accent. Call him and only be trained by Q. Anyway, so I call up Heliair in London, and I said, can I speak to Q? And this voice comes down the phone like I'll never forget, like it's something of a 1920s commercial. It goes, Q speaking, like this, right? And I'm like, wow. This guy's like the real deal. He goes, how can I help you? I said, Q, my name is Greg Secker. I'm a good friend of Rich Scott's. You taught him to fly many moons ago, and apparently you're the guy to learn to fly with. He goes, I am that man. I said, right, well, like, I'm really excited. I think you're the guy. He goes, Greg, I would love to train you. He goes, but I have a challenge. I'm training the London Air Ambulance Paramedic School. I'm unavailable for 6 weeks. I said, okay, I understand. I said, I'd like to get going, Ali. I said, but can you just tell me everything I'd need to do in order to learn how to fly a helicopter and become a pilot? He says, Greg, do you have a pen and paper? I said, yeah. Okay, I'll get one. He goes, write this down. This guy talks nonstop for 45 minutes, just goes through it, everything I have to do, all the hours, all the flight training, all the exams, all the medicals, everything, soup to nuts, the books I need to buy, the DVDs, the immersion trainings, all the full of shit. I'm like, I'm writing this down. Like 7 pages of notes, literally by the time I stop. So he's, because all the time for 45 minutes, I've been entertained. And I'm thinking, fuck me, man. If I'm going to learn to fly a helicopter, I've got to do it with this idiot sat next to me, because he's hilarious, right? So I'm excited. I'm like, Q, I said, this has been a fun experience. I said, but you've got to be the guy that teaches me. He goes, sorry. He goes, as I said, London Air Ambulance School beckons. Anyway, give me a call in 6 weeks. And then he just goes, clunk. I'm like, fuck, he's hung up. So my guys were looking at me and goes, well, what happened? I go, he's hung up. So I call him back and I went, Q, I think the phone went dead. You know, all of a sudden you're just gone. He goes, no, that was it. I'm like, wow. I said, listen, I'm really keen on you being the guy that teaches me. And I'm trying to think fast because I now want to lock this guy in. And so I said to him, how do people pay for this stuff? He goes, well, we just bill them every month. We send them an invoice for the hours. I said, well, okay, what would it cost me start to finish to fly, have my license, and maybe get a helicopter, but you know, be finished, out licensed pilot? He says, how coordinated are you? You don't sound very coordinated. So, in your case, I'd put £70,000 on budget. I'm like, whew. That's a lot of money. I'm like, okay, well, I said, I'll tell you what, I'm going to Barclays. That's our bank in London. I'm going to be there this afternoon making some other deposits. I'll tell you what I'll do. I'm going to wire you £70,000. It'll be in your bank by 5 o'clock this evening. He goes, Greg, you do that? You start next week. People may die, but somebody's got to pay the fucking bills around here. So the point is, step three is write this down, schedule it and lock the door behind you. Schedule it and lock the door behind you, meaning do something which commits you to doing it. Here's what I've learned from some of the most successful people I've had the opportunity to spend time with. Successful people make it easy to move forward and difficult to move back. Unsuccessful people make it really difficult to move forward, very easy to back out. Does that make sense? You've got to set the game up so it's really easy to move forward and hit the goal, but really painful and awkward and difficult and ugly to go back. When I teach people to trade, I said, how important is it to you that you make this thing happen? And they go, it's really important. I go, is it important to anyone else around you? And they go, yeah. I go, promise them. They'll hold you accountable. Does that make sense? Promise them. Tell your spouse, tell your girlfriend, tell your boyfriend, you're going to make yourself £40,000 a month. Tell them. They'll hold you accountable, especially if they're a benefactor. You know what I mean? So schedule it and lock the door behind you. And number four is get around the path, or spend time with people who are doing it and making a lot of money doing it. And this is the difference that makes the difference. I've been really fortunate to do this. It's now 15 years later, and having run trading floors and owning trading floors and trading centers, having taught thousands of people around the world how to do it, what's interesting is the very core of what I do is still the same practically as it was many years ago. Things have changed, markets change, and of course we update strategies to make sure they're even more potent in current market conditions, but it's allowed me to do a lot. And what I'd like to do, if you don't mind, I'd like to play you a video of the kind of stuff I get up to now trading the foreign exchange market, because once for me in the old days, it started as an IT guy on a trading floor, knowing nothing about this, learning a few tricks. It's culminated and we run a foundation and we run this whole organization based on currency trading. So with your permission, can I play you a video that I think is really cool just to demonstrate kind of what we do and why we teach people like you how to make money trading, because we kind of get you involved in this foundation that we do all around the world, which is really cool. So can I play the video to you guys? You want to see that? Okay, here we go.
Hi, this is Greg Secker, and I'm at the Denham Airfield, and you might be wondering what I'm doing here today. Well, in a minute, I'm about to get in that helicopter and start trading the currency markets live. If you are a trader, you're going to be following me as we trade the markets live from the sky, and whilst we can have some fun making some money and generating some income, we can also make some money for a worthwhile cause too.
Next door, we have over 50 people trading simultaneously as they follow the live trade. We also have over 150 people worldwide following us from home.
Everybody's excited and trying to get in on the trades.
Down at Knowledge to Action today, to see the Knowledge to Action Foundation and a flying trader in full swing, it's incredible.
It's very high energy, good fun, learning a huge amount.
I didn't realise it was going to be just so alive.
50 traders in the room, they're up over 400 pips. It's a fantastic day. Everybody's having a lot of fun. It's for a great cause and we're incredibly proud.
It's going great, really exciting. The atmosphere's just really, really, really fantastic.
I've seen different strategies being used. Absolutely incredible amount of experience they've got.
A lot of the atmosphere's been fantastic, but I've learned so much.
I think it really is amazing. You know, he's up in his helicopter and he's trying to find these trades. It's just so surreal, actually.
Okay, here we are at the Canary Wharf. Let's look at the euro position right now. You can see it's lined up, perfect position, now going short.
We've already made over 400 pips, which is incredibly successful.
Yeah, a bit jealous, really, that he's up there and we're down here, but some of the trade calls have been very useful and learning a lot from all the guys running the course.
There's some money to be made, and I believe they're up quite nicely already early into the trading sessions.
Great reward risk, great trade. Let's get the position on.
I made about 1.5%, so it was really good.
It was an incredible experience.
All of the profits today will be going to two very important charities. Number one, the Ubuntu Education Fund in South Africa, and Barnardo's here in the UK.
The funds raised will go towards Barnardo's works, a really, really important part of the work that we do with the young people, helping them lead independent lives.
This will enable us to transform the lives of hundreds of orphaned and vulnerable children in South Africa.
Both of these charities support children in need, and so thank you very much for your support.
We've placed a lot of trades, we've made a load of money, I hope you have too. It's bye for now, but we look forward to seeing you at the next Flying Trader.
Cool, thank you. Good, thanks very much, that's very kind. Okay. So that's something I'm very passionate about, and that's what we do all over the world. We set up our trading floors, and then we kind of run this mad project behind it, and it is a mad... Everyone thinks it's glamorous, flying in a helicopter, trading the markets. It's like a freaking greenhouse in the sky up there. 8 hours with the sun beaming down, you're sweating, you're jiggered to death, but nonetheless, we've done well. We've raised nearly... we'll make £400,000 for those two charities by May next year, which is pretty exciting, so I'm kind of cool there. Now, we ask the people we teach to trade to be involved in that, so once a month they get to trade live, and follow me, they follow the trade calls on a website. It's a really nice way of teaching people. When I teach someone to trade, often they just need and want to make more money. You get them to a stage where they're making decent money and they're making a little bit more than they thought they'd be making, and then you get them to a stage where they're giving back a little bit and doing something else. I think you create a real nice cycle with people. So I'd like to kind of then now kind of drop that onto you, and I want you to think now, If I could just jump to the PowerPoints, that'd be great. And this is really about getting you guys focused. I'd like you to write down two things, not three, two, right now. Imagine, I want you to imagine that in the next 6 months, you're making at least an additional $40,000 on top of what you're traditionally bringing in. I'd like you to write down two things that you would give yourself that you currently have not given yourself. And I think it's very important that you do that right now. And the reason I say that is I teach the mechanics of how to do that, and I've shown you some of the stuff that you need to do in order to make the money. But I think unless we put the spark plug in the engine, in other words, unless you make it relevant to you personally, and that often is what you get out of this, why you would do this, then I think it's irrelevant. Because I've got to tell you this, I can cajole you, I can tell you some funny stories, I can also give you some information, but unless you take action and do something with it and it's meaningful for you, it all becomes for nothing. I've got to tell you, the richest people in the world set goals, and after they do that, we need to then break down exactly what needs to be done. Let me tell you just kind of briefly how, let's say I sat with one of you and you said to me, I want to make $40,000, Greg, and I need to be making that every month within the next 6 or 8 months. Here's the process. We sit there and say, okay, if you're here, we need to establish where you are first, this is where you want to go, and then we need to break it down into chunks, and that says, well, okay, how much money do you need to start with? Or how much trading do you need to do? How much time do you need to give it? How many trades do you need to be placing per week or per month? And then we look at you and we say, when are you free? We look at your time frame availability and we match it up with a strategy that works best with you. I'm going to talk about resonance in a minute, which is critical to making money. Certain things in this life will resonate with you more than other things. And establishing what resonates. Do you guys understand what I mean when I say resonate? Yes or no? Resonate means kind of like vibrates with your core. This is an easy way for you to make money. I really don't believe that you should ever try and make money with something which doesn't resonate with you. You'll never be successful at it, and you'll just keep bashing your head against it. So I teach people a number of different trading strategies, and we have them play with them in a kind of a childlike fashion, if you like, for a few weeks, and we figure out the one which resonates with them. We put the plan around that, and that's what they go off and make their money with. Let me tell you this. If you've got a successful trading strategy which is making you a lot of money, how many strategies do you need? The answer is one, and one alone. So I'm going to talk to you a little bit about how we do it. If I can just, someone could click that slide on for me, that'd be really, really useful. Okay. So if you could just click the slide on, this thing stopped working. So if, that's great, thank you. And again. Okay, so look at this diagram up here. I have no idea. Okay, forget the diagram. Okay, so there was a diagram where it had a bunch of ingredients on it. It had flour, it had butter, it had milk, all that kind of stuff. We're going to get to that in a minute if you could just jump to it. Basically, imagine if I was going to teach you to trade, or if I was going to teach you to cook by asking you to study all the ingredients of something. Well, trying to study all the ingredients of something is going to make the process long-winded, impossible, and you're going to lose your, thank you so much, awesome. And it's going to make you lose your drive. And the problem is, most people, when they think about learning to trade, they think they have to learn everything, the almanac of trading. I always say to people, look, forget about it. Listen to this, I don't teach people how to trade. That's not what I do. People go, yeah, you do, that's exactly what you're going. No, I don't. I say, I teach people how to make money from trading. In other words, if you're somebody who sat there today saying, well, in order for me to feel comfortable doing this, making money trading, I need to know everything, I would be the wrong guy to work with. I don't do that whatsoever. There is way too much to know. You need at least a 4-year degree in Harvard studying super economics to really understand what's going on with the flows of the currency markets today. It's massive. So that's one way of doing it. The other way of doing it is saying, okay, let's look at the 3 or 4 opportunities that present themselves every single day where you could make between 50 and 100 pips. What would be more useful? The first, knowing everything, or in my opinion, the second, which tells you what to do, when to do it, and then get the hell out of there. Do you guys understand what I'm trying to say? So I don't believe in teaching you everything. So of course, you then have to make some discretionary approach on how to do it. And that would be the same as, if I could just quickly jump to, let's have a look. Yeah, back, there we go. So this would be the same as saying, look, you know, if we're gonna make a cake, where the flour came from, which cow gave us the milk, which chicken pooped out the egg, or where the butter came from is unimportant. The key is, how do we get to the result? Well, we need to know what the recipe looks like. Let me just be able to go back a sec here. This thing's just flicking way out of control. Okay, so let's say this is the result we want. Well, to get the result we want, we just need to follow the recipe of the creator who did it in the first place. Don't do that and just focus purely on the ingredients themselves. You end up with a poop cake. So I believe first and foremost, you need to know what to do. That's the mechanics, the strategy. Then you need to spend a little bit of time with the person that put the game together, which in this case would be the chef, or more importantly, in my world, it would be someone like that, me, and sit there and do it live with them. So there's two parts of this, isn't it? The first part, of course, is the recipe, what to do and when to do it, and then doing it live with somebody. And I believe if you're going to give birth to a successful trader within you, and you can be other things too, you don't just need to be a trader, but there should be a part of your day if you want to make some decent money. In my opinion, certainly my experience, making money in this world today, there is nothing that stands anywhere near the currency markets. Well, that means in order to give birth to that in you, you need to spend a little bit of time with somebody who's doing it. The company I run, this is my show-off slide, but the company I run has become the 49th fastest growing organization in Great Britain. We run, obviously, trading floors all over the world. The reason it's become so successful is because the people that we teach to do this go off and make a lot of money, and they come back, and then they become people who then trade on our trading floors around the world, and that makes a very successful organization. The foundation, as you saw, then becomes something we then bolt onto it. So wherever we have one of our trading centers around the world, we run foundation activities so that the traders, who are the people like yourselves who often make money, they can actually then contribute to the foundation and do other things with it. So it becomes a really nice process. Now, how does it all come together? Well, there are three elements: immersion training, successful strategy, and click, click, click. Good. That doesn't work. And then live one-on-one coaching. So what we do is we take you, we put you in a training center, and we train you for 2 days, which means that you won't learn the whole market. You'll sit there trading live with a trainer who's going to trade the currency markets. And you're just going to see how one of three trading strategies are put in the market and executed live. It's important that we don't fill your mind up with all the ingredients, just the strategies, which is what to do and when to do it. Then you start trading live on a trading floor. So you'll sit on our, we have a trading floor purpose-built here in Australia, which I opened 18 months ago. It's one of the most successful trading floors we have around the world. We're just starting a big fund here as well. And you'll sit there with one of the traders and you'll trade live and you'll actually watch them trade their account alongside you trading your account. And I believe that is the process whereby you really get to build belief in yourself. Does that work now? Yeah, cool. So in order to make it happen, we need to know who you are. So that's the process. You learn to trade for 2 days. You understand the mechanics. Then you've got to figure out, well, who am I in this? And the who you are in this is the following. The different trading strategies resonate with different people. So we teach three. From all the trading activity we do around the world, my organization trades 24 hours a day, 5 days a week. If we're trading in London, we'll trade the London session. When we go to sleep, Australia takes over, Johannesburg then takes over, then in America. So it's running constantly. And the reason we do that is there's money to be made 24 hours a day. We even teach people these days how to automate it so they don't even need to trade themselves. That makes it extremely powerful. Now, there are three systems. Let me run through very quickly what they are. There's a system, please write this down, called the sniper trade. And this has been very, very successful worldwide. We use 4 time frames of reference to look at the markets and give us a signal. Now, why do we use 4 time frames of reference? Well, the 4 time frames are the following. Write these down. Daily, 4 hour, 1 hour, 5 minutes. There are 4 distinctly different time frames of reference that the world looks at the currency. And if those 4 time frames of reference, those 4 different trading groups are making the same decision on the same currency pair at the same time in the same direction, is it likely that currency is going to move? And the answer to that question is yes. It's probably going to move between 50 and 80 points. We are looking to take about 25 points. We want to be in, take the money, close the position down. This happens 24 hours a day in all trading sessions all around the world. It's called the sniper trade. We sell this to people who literally want to trade 24 hours a day. So we have groups of traders, we have banks or fund managers or fund traders, more importantly, prop traders, who say, we just want to learn this strategy. We come, we train them on it, we charge them $2,500, and off they go, and that's what they do. We have other groups of people who don't want to do that, don't have the time to trade like that, and they want to trade end of day, which means they place their positions in the morning. All of the trading strategies you're seeing are based on London trading times, because London is still the trading center of the foreign exchange world. 90% of the flow goes through London, because London trades with America and Southeast Asia and Australia longer than anywhere else in the world. We have extended trading hours in London. So the strategy of the income generator, which alerts you that there's a trade happening at midnight in London, is about 9 o'clock in the morning here. So sociable hours, interestingly, trading this strategy here. We charge $2,500 for it, and literally people trade the income generator, and it runs between, write this down, between 3 or 4 days. That's how long the position runs. And you're looking to pull about 200 to 300 points on those trades, which is about $10 a pip. You're looking at $2,000 to $3,000. So a very, very powerful trading strategy, but it's not one of those things where you sit there needing to look at it. Again, it can be automated. And the very last one here is the pivot trades, which is pivot trading is what I showed you at the beginning where I made the 19,000 in 4 minutes. You'll have wanted to have trade for about 4 to 6 weeks before you start doing this. It's not more complicated. It's just you need to understand what you're doing a little bit more. So this is after a month or two of trading the other two strategies. The pivot system, you're targeting much more. You're targeting 200 to 300 points a week. We sell it for £2,500. People just go off and pivot trade. A lot of floor traders I sell this to all over America and the UK, and that's what they do, one of those systems. Now, I believe for people like yourselves who may have never done this before, I think you need to understand what resonates with you the most. So we put all three together in one program. And my question to you is this. Do you believe sitting there today, seeing some of the systems I've demonstrated to you, understanding some of how it works, do you guys believe you can do this? Yes or no? Well, let's see if we can get you guys behind this.